songs of praise.
On the programme, I meet a trainee vicar who used to be a heavy metal singer.
You know, you don't need to be some kind of pious person to come forward to the priesthood, because we're not like that at all, are we?
Well, you speak for yourself.
We revisit the pioneer ministers in Birmingham, whose church in a yurt is helping transform their neighbourhood.
People who normally wouldn't feel that comfortable in church have really opened up.
And we catch up with Baroness Lawrence, mother of Stephen Lawrence, to find out more about how she draws strength from her Christian beliefs.
For me, I think I've been carried, I think, in a lot of ways.
Ripon College in Cuddeston, Oxfordshire, was established in 1854 by Bishop Samuel Wilberforce, the son of famous anti-slavery campaigner William Wilberforce.
It's one of the Church of England's largest centres for training ministers. They even have their own dramatically designed chapel, and we have a stunning choral performance from there a little later on. But we begin our hymns with a Charles Wesley classic, Rejoice, the Lord is King.
For 165 years, these beautiful grounds in Oxfordshire have seen men and women coming to live, study and worship in preparation for ordination to the priesthood. Canon Professor Mark Chapman has been teaching trainee clergy for almost three decades.
Mark, I remember my own days at theological college with huge fondness, and particularly the tutors. What's it like for you?
Well, it's still good. I've been here for 27 years, and every year brings its new joys, new challenges, new people. But it's still one of those great places where you see people change and grow and develop through the years that they're here. I think it's good for people to come from all different walks, because they're meeting the needs of people in all sorts of different backgrounds, and to show some kind of similarity from where they're coming from to the people they're ministering with. That's in itself is something that's crucial for the development of the church.
One of Ripon College's current students also runs a pub.
Yeah, I've been at church this morning preaching.
43-year-old Emily Coltbight has been studying to become a vicar for the past year.
I've been running this wonderful pub, the Chandos Arms, for 5 years with my husband. I used to be a professional musician. I used to sing in this heavy metal band, all dressed in rubber and leather armour. These are the beasts, the apes in their cages, and I will... And my life just somehow started to move towards the church, and I slowly got more involved in it. And then about 3 years ago, I had this sort of sense of calling that started nagging away at me. I was in Lanzarote on a family holiday, and I decided to go for a little walk down the beach, and I'd been drinking some sangria and eating some snacks and things. And I walked down the beach and went up this little mountain, and when I got up there, I had this really vivid sense that God was really present with me. You know, the air got very fat and sparkly, and I was like, I am in the presence of God right now. And I looked down in my hand, and I had a big goblet of sangria, red sangria, and in my other hand was a round Pringle. And I was like, oh no, here I am, and I'm being called to celebrate the Eucharist. I think people must realise that you don't have to have a spotless past. You know, you don't need to be some kind of pious person to come forward to the priesthood, because we're not like that at all, are we?
Well, you speak for yourself.
No, of course not.
We'll be catching up with Emily again later and finding out about her time in the Holy Land with Songs of Praise.
Our next hymn comes from Stockbridge Church in Edinburgh and is all about God calling us to trust and follow him. Our faith can give us the strength to get through the most difficult of times. 26 years ago, London teenager Stephen Lawrence was killed in an unprovoked racist attack. Last year, Sean Fletcher went to meet his mother to find out how God helped and to learn about everything she's now doing for her community.
Doreen Lawrence, now Baroness Lawrence, is someone I admire hugely. For 18 years after the death of Stephen in April 1993, she led a relentless campaign to seek justice for her son.
The police failed to solve the case. Mistakes were made, which led to a public inquiry. It took almost two decades, until 2012, before two of Stephen's killers were finally found guilty of his murder. Doreen and I have come to St Matthew's Church in Westminster.
Stephen loved life. He had a mischievous smile. He loved his music. He loved going out. And I'm sure he would have had a really, really successful life. There was nothing to make me think that Stephen would be in danger within that area where we lived.
Stephen and his friend had been waiting at a bus stop when Stephen was murdered in a racially motivated attack.
Were you angry with God?
At the beginning, I was. Because, you know, why my son? Why him? It was much later, before the answer came, because of all the things that's been changing his name.
Is time a great healer, though, in terms of the loss?
I think for me, still as raw as it was the first day, because I haven't had the opportunity to grieve like a lot of families would have done, because I spent the past so many years fighting for justice.
Doreen has achieved justice for Stephen and has been at the forefront of raising awareness of institutional racism. And since we met her last year, she's launched a brand new project. In May, she officially opened the Stephen Lawrence Research Centre at De Montfort University in Leicester.
It's an amazing space. I mean, as you start, you walk around, it gives you the whole, like, the beginning of the history of Stephen. And for me, I wanted somewhere that you talk about the positive things, you know, what his name has done.
The centre will host debates on social justice for people of all ages and will offer resources to those researching topics including institutional racism and racial violence. It's been an emotional project for Doreen, who's donated many of Stephen's personal belongings to the centre.
Before, I think I probably had difficulty in sharing a lot of stuff, and I just think, Stephen's my son, he's mine, and he's not anyone else's. But I think as we move forward, I think Stephen's legacy is something that it needs to be shared. Walking around the centre, it gives me two different things. Pride to know that this is all about my son and what he's achieved. And then you have the other bit, that you just think that he should be here with us, that, you know, he should have had life, and that was sort of taken away from him. I think my faith is very important, and I tend to always ask him for guidance, and I think many a times I get it, you know, because, you know, we don't know what each day is going to bring, and I think I've been carried, I think, in a lot of ways. What I always ask for is strength and guidance, and that's, for me, is enough.
Faithful.
big part of ordination training and life here at Ripon College is reflection and meditation, so I've managed to find myself a nice quiet corner. Our next song is all about the stillness and the peace of God, recorded at St Elizabeth's Church, Reddish. As we know, Christian calling takes many different forms, and last year I met a Birmingham couple whose faith work is helped by a gorgeous breed of animal, not often seen in a British city. This is Winson Green, which hit the headlines when Channel 4 made their controversial documentary series Benefit Street here. Now, as well as the established community, many asylum seekers and refugees have made a home here. But the last thing I expected to find was alpacas. Now, you must be Ash and Anji.
Yeah.
What gave it away?
Would you like a go?
Oh, would I like a go? Are you kidding me? I've never done this before. Is there any trick to it?
No, you just walk along and they'll follow you.
Okay. Yeah.
Reverends Anji and Ash Barker describe themselves as pioneer ministers. They followed their Christian calling to come and live in this part of Birmingham in 2014.
We find that walking them to and from school is a great way to meet the neighbours, and it's really good breaking down barriers with kids who don't speak any English as well.
Ash and Anji are originally from Australia and have spent their lives working in poor areas around the world. They were asked by the Church of England to move into this vicarage in Winson Green to run it as a community house to help the neighbourhood.
Just recently I went to visit a family. There were 20 people in a two-bedroom house just street behind us. So people are living in tiny spaces with no gardens. And so we thought, well, here's this big community asset where we can create a place for people to gather together and to just meet each other and reduce that isolation. And there's always a bed for somebody who finds himself in crisis, or a place to leave your child when you need a break. Well, it's horrendous poverty that we're seeing emerge. It's an opportunity for the church to get back to doing what we were called to do, and that's to love people and care for people.
Nearly a year on, and Ash and Anji are busier than ever. Their home has become an even bigger community hub.
We just couldn't fit any more people in Newbigin House. It was 300 people a week, and we just needed to do something. It was crazy. And I went to visit someone in London, and in the backyard, someone had a yurt, which is like a Mongolian tent. And I thought, we don't need an extension. What we really need is a yurt. So we have church in a yurt every Sunday now. And so it does create that special intimacy together in a circle.
To connect with others, to use our gifts.
People who normally wouldn't feel that comfortable in church find that place really comforting and have really opened up and become part of our church in a yurt. For so long, Winson Green is a place that's been talked about, you know, people looking down on it. But a change is starting to happen and people are starting to know each other and starting to do life together. And I think God's really at the centre of that. And all of the things that we do are the methods, not the mission. The mission is to see people's lives transformed for Christ. And the method might be having an alpaca or a kids club or a church in the yurt. But those things we hold loosely because in a year's time, they may not actually be effective, but our mission doesn't change.
God's our vision and God's promise for this neighbourhood to become a thriving place, a place of love and compassion and justice. If God's our vision, then we can keep going even though it's difficult.